Right, how y'all doing? That was sort of weak. Let's try it again. How y'all doing? It's a beautiful day for the Broncos to win.
Packers.
Come on, somebody. You got to do better than that. Anyway, we just, seriously, a bunch of people coming in. Want to say welcome to 3D. Great to have you here. Welcome our friends. Join us online as well. For those of you that have known me for a while or know me relatively well or been around, you knew that I grew up on a farm, actually, in northwest Illinois. And how many of you know when you grow up on a farm, you grow up around a lot of different things, you learn a good work ethic, and you're surrounded by stuff? How many of you know what I'm talking about? And stuff like, how many of you are familiar with something like this? Chicken feet. Well, almost, but as you can see, it's just natural organic. So what do you think that means? Help me out, somebody. You know, if you do a little investigation and read the fine print on the back, it says ingredients contained within, you'll discover, I need a volunteer, but it actually contains some of this. How many of you know what this is? Yeah, don't say certain things out loud. Just acknowledge you know what it's in. And when it says just natural, organic, how many of you know organic means? It's the real deal is in there. And you're saying, well, what's your point, Keith? Well, actually, it's a great picture of what it means for something to move from being, how we agree, useless to becoming useful. And that is precisely what this series that we've been in for the last few weeks is all about. We're wrapping it up today. We've been in it for a few weeks. The series is called Onesimus, which is the name of the guy in the letter that Paul wrote to Philemon. And give you a little more background, he was a runaway slave, and he ran away from his owner, Philemon. And in the journey, actually even ripped him off and some different things. Now, some of you were wondering, so what's the whole Onesimus deal? I mean, like, what's it mean? Actually, his name means useful. Useful. And so when Paul referenced him, he uses a little play on words in the context of his writing. He says, formerly he was, how many would agree, formerly he was useless to you, but now he's become useful both to you and to me. Still waiting for a volunteer. Just kidding. And here's the point. How did that happen? Well, he had what we call a pote de nuni experience. Those words are actually the original language that's used in the writing of the New Testament in Greek. And he's saying this whole idea of pote, what once was, de nuni, is no more. In other words, the past is gone and the new is here. And as a result of that, this guy named Onesimus, whose name literally means useful, all of a sudden now has great use, not just because he's going to return to his owner, Philemon, but because he's now returning as a believer. It's a powerful, powerful story, and that's why we spent 3 weeks on one short chapter. Now, some of you have wondered what the name Onesimus means, and somebody guessed before we even launched a series that it was about, thought maybe it was like an adult onesie, and we said that we'd sort of have somebody to feature that today. That individual, I almost wanted to make light of it, but we do have a picture. This is the way that Jared chose to show up. He honestly was going to be here, and unfortunately his mom is undergoing some pretty serious tests this morning, and so I'm just going to pause right now and invite you to join us in prayer for Jared's mom. Can we do that? Father, we thank you that you are our healer and our health. We thank you so much for Jared and his family, and we're just asking right now, God, that you would give great wisdom to the medical team that's attending to her needs. We pray in all the testing that there would come an accurate diagnosis, and independent of what it is, we acknowledge that you're the healer, and we're asking you to bring healing and restoration to her body, and just let your grace and peace wash over the heart and the mind, really the emotions of Jared and his family. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so let's dive back in here. And let's just read some of the text from Philemon, and then we'll talk about it as we wrap up this series today. Philemon chapter 1, verse 10, my plea is that you show kindness to Onesimus. So again, Paul wrote this letter in an effort to try and bring the two of them back together. He says, I think of him as my own son because he became a believer as a result of my ministry here in prison. Formerly, here's those words, formerly, pote, he was useless to you, but now, that means de nuni, he has become useful both to you and to me. I am sending him back to you, and with him comes my own heart. I really wanted to keep him here with me for a while I'm in these chains for preaching the good news, and he would have helped me on your behalf, but I didn't want to do anything without your consent. And I didn't want you to help, because you were forced to, but because you wanted to. Now, here's the key phrase we're going to highlight today. Perhaps you could think of it this way. We're going to come back to that. Onesimus ran away for a little while so you could have him back forever. Boy, there's so many layers to this. Have you ever thought about that God may have allowed you to go a certain direction for a little while so that all of a sudden he could redirect the path of your life and you could become useful forever? He is no longer just a slave. He is a beloved brother, especially to me. Now, he will mean much more to you both as a slave and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, give him the same welcome you would give me if I were coming. Let's say it together. Perhaps you could think of it this way. Let's say that together. Yeah, perhaps you could think of it what way? To be useful. We must not only, listen to me, to be useful, we must not only come to Christ as Onesimus did, but we must change the way we think. We have to change our perspective. We have to change how we view God, how we view ourselves, how we view this thing called life. In other words, can I just say this? And this is actually pretty tweetable. A change of perspective can literally change your life. Think about that. A change of perspective can literally change your life. Many of you maybe walked in here today based upon something that's transpired in your life. You walked in, you had a smile on your face, but if the truth were known and we spent some time with you, you don't feel real useful. There's been a voice in your head that said, you can never really be used by God in a great way. After all, look at what you have done. Or you've been told by someone else that you'll never amount to much. Some of you heard those voices as a kid growing up. Well, why can't you be like so-and-so? Or you'll never accomplish much because of X, Y, Z. Some of you have been called or labeled useless. So how do you get past that? How do you get past your past? I want to talk about thinking that leads to being useful. Perhaps you could think of this way. Just two thoughts that I want to introduce today that I believe will lead to some real change in our lives and I believe even our impact potential. So let's dive in. First of all, replace the old with the new. Replace the old with the new. Philemon 1:11, we already referenced it. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he's become useful both to you and to me. When you put your faith in Christ, how many of you know, you become one of his children. You become what the Bible calls a child of God. And you don't just get something when you surrender your life to Christ. You become someone who didn't exist before. In other words, you don't just get forgiveness, receive forgiveness. You don't just get, you know, God's grace. You don't just receive his love. You don't just receive eternal life. You don't just receive the Holy Spirit. You become, the Bible says, a new creation. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says, for if anyone is in Christ, he's what? A new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. Pote de nuni. It's all over the pages of Scripture. When someone encounters Christ, something happens. The old is gone and the new has come. How many would agree it's great when the old is gone and the new has come? How many of you have seen the bumper sticker? Stuff happens, right? But aren't you grateful that grace happens? That's really the story of the Bible. That really is. That's the story of the Bible. Some of you are never going to forget this, and that's good. And so But the word new creation there literally means another of a different kind. And so we understand what once was is no more. This is what happens when any of us enter into a life-giving relationship with Jesus Christ. And so you're a new creation, another of a different kind. You have a whole new identity. In fact, this thing has been resonating so strongly with me. We're launching a brand new series next weekend called Selfie. How many are excited about it already? Because I've been on social media. I've seen your pictures. And we are going to take you hostage. And we're actually going to give like some kind of a gift card every week for, like, you know, the funniest selfie, maybe the worst selfie. How about the most selfless selfie? Yeah, each week we're going to give out awards. And we're going to dive into that series next week. You don't want to miss it. But here's the point. As you grow in your understanding of your new identity, you get a clear picture of your destiny. Can I say that again? As you grow in your understanding of your new identity, you get a clear picture of your destiny. Because we can't live beyond what we believe. And what we believe will determine how we behave. So if what we believe isn't right, how we live won't be right either. Therefore, the answer to transformation and change is not to attack certain behaviors, but rather to address certain belief systems. That's what brings change. And so it says in Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. This is not of yourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, so that nobody can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." See, here it is. In Christ, you and I are destined, we are destined for usefulness. It's, I believe, through our faith in Him, hardwired into our DNA. You're destined for usefulness. We've been created for good works. God has blessed you with gifts and abilities and talents and experiences and all kinds of stuff. And when you invest those in serving others, you're being used by God to impact not just a life, but generations to come. That makes you useful. So the question I would ask before we move on to our second point here today is simply this. Here's the question. What is it? Or maybe I should word it this way. What lie do you need to renounce that you have believed or that somebody else announced over you that is not consistent with biblical truth and what God says about you? What lie do you need to renounce and what truth do you need to embrace? What lie have you believed? Maybe it's about something somebody said, or maybe it's about your own past and poor choices you made. But here's the good news that makes the good news really good news, and that is this, that even if you feel held back by your own poor choices, which is true for almost all of us, God is the one who has the ability to take that and turn it around and use it for good and turn that which seems useless into something that's useful. That's just how good He is. That's why it's the gospel, which means good news. So what's a lie that you need to renounce and a truth that you need to embrace? That's all about changing our thinking from old to new. Second is realize or see the good through the bad. This isn't a denial of the bad, but rather choosing to see good through the bad, the possibilities of what could be. Here's what most of us do. Tell me if this isn't true. So I grew up on a farm. I had that reference point. Fast forward the tape. I went to college for business. I'm in a business partnership. I sell out of that because God says, I have a plan for your life that's different than your plan for your life. And I transition into vocational ministry. And now I'm working on staff at a church. And we lived in this really neat home. It was probably our favorite home for our family growing up. And we had, back in Illinois in the Midwest, and we had these big trees. I mean, we had willow trees and oak trees and hard maple trees. And they were massive. And at this time of year, they begin to dump an incredible dump of leaves. And I mean fun. Like, gather them up and let the kids jump off the deck into them. That kind of a stack of leaves. And so they did. And we'd keep piling them up. And I had piled up and they were sort of, you know, breaking down. Some of them were smashed. New leaves were falling. And piled them up. And there was the forecast that was coming through that said that there was snow on the way, and it was for the Midwest, an incredibly early snow. And Julie said, "Keith, you know, these leaves, you probably ought to deal with them and get them off of the grass, because If you understand what it's like in the Midwest, when winter comes, it just stays like forever. And it rains and it snows and it melts and then it snows some more, and you leave leaves on top of nice sod and grass, and come spring and you don't get it off, it'll kill the grass. So she wisely advised me to get the leaves picked up and get rid of them. And I said, yeah, babe, I'll do that. And the next day she reminded me one more time, said, you know, the storm's coming through tonight. You know, like today would be the right day to do that. And I said, yeah, babe, thanks. And guess what? I didn't do that. And I know none of you guys have ever failed to listen to your spouse, but this is to coach you in case you ever are tempted to. You might want to follow their advice. It's usually pretty good. And so I didn't listen to her, and it snowed. And I mean, we got a dump, like 12 inches of snow. And it just landed, and it was one of those, because it was early, it was one of those really wet snows. Most of you in Colorado don't know what wet snow is. You're saying, well, Keith, all snow is wet because it's made out of, no, I mean like wet snow, like heavy, wet. And it just dumped, and then, you know, it warmed up, and it melted a little bit, not completely, and so it just sort of froze because it got cold again, and then it snowed some more. And fast forward the tape. Now it's spring. And we have this massive pile of leaves out there that somebody failed to rake up in the fall. And now it's spring, and that same somebody was encouraged to deal with the leaves. So finally one day, it's a beautiful day. I mean, it's like spring now, and it's the sun is shining. That happens like 4 days of the year where we used to live. And that was an exaggeration. I'm really dissing the Midwest, aren't I? We love the people, just not the weather, okay? For those of you watching, we love you. You can have your weather. And so I'm out there raking up these leaves. This is a true story. I'm not inflating or exaggerating any of this. And I'm raking up these leaves. Now, I know that most of you do everything with great joy and elation, especially a task that you don't prefer to do. But I'm about a third of the way into this, maybe not even halfway, and I'm starting to complain a little bit. And I'm like, this blankety blank. These leaves, you know. And who am I going to blame? I mean, I'd been well advised. I've been well informed it was going to snow. And so I'm raking up these leaves, and I'm grumbling and complaining, and all I can see is this. Seriously. I mean, it sort of looked like that. And I'm raking up, and it's wet, and it's just thick, and it's heavy, and yeah, and the grass underneath it is already starting to fade, and I'm like, oh, man, I better get this done, you know, and even though I didn't want to, and I'm raking it up. And in the middle of my raking and my complaining, the Holy Spirit really just began to whisper and said, you know what? That's a great commentary on most people's lives. They view their past and the junk that's fallen into the yard of their life as a bunch of, you fill in the blank, waste. And then he said, all they need to do is surrender it to me. And I'll take the stuff of their life when it's put in my hands and turn it into compost that, if used by my leading, can actually lead to greater fruitfulness than they could have ever experienced without it. And here's the point. How many of us have some stuff that we're cursing, we're complaining, we're regretting deeply? In fact, we just assume that it never happened, so we want to pretend like it never happened and cover it over like it was never a part of our journey, our narrative, our story. And God's saying, I can't use it as long as you curse it. But if you'll release it to me, I'll take it and transform it. And it becomes the fertilizer bed for greater growth, not just in your own life, but for the lives of all those around you that will be impacted by it than you ever imagined. But you've got to let me have it. Today, I believe the Holy Spirit's inviting every one of us in this place to take whatever it is that's a part of our past and surrender it into the very capable hands of a great God who came to pote de nuni, Take that which once was and make it so it is no more, and all of a sudden you move from being useless to being incredibly useful to our great God. Come on, somebody. That's the message of the gospel. That's the good news that God has to offer. And so rather than denying what happened, let's just be honest about it. And think about what Onesimus and Philemon had to be thinking. How could anything good come out of this? He's nothing but a slave. He ripped me off. And now you, Paul, on your high horse, think that I should take him back and forgive him. We already covered that in the first 2 weeks. And Onesimus has got to be freaking out. Onesimus has got to be thinking, at a minimum, I'm going to be beaten and branded. Philemon's got to be thinking, there's no way that I can come out of this with a win. Even if I take him back, because of the 60 million slaves that were in the Roman Empire of that day, thinking, I am not setting a good precedent here, and my life is at risk. There's no way I can win. That may very well be where many of you are at. You're facing something, and all you can see are the negatives, how bad the situation is, or how much you've messed up in your past. You're thinking, I could never bring that into the light and make it a part of conversation. You're wondering, how do I get past it? By renewing your mind. Your mind is the battleground. Therefore, if you're going to change and live out your God-ordained usefulness, you have to change the way you think. Romans 12:2 makes it real clear. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. Get this phrase. This is a beautiful phrase. But let God transform you into a new person. How? By changing the way you think. Listen, we don't change ourselves. We don't transform ourselves. We don't move ourselves from this pile to this pile. Only God can do that, but He moves us from this pile to that pile when we change the way we think about who He is, who we are, what He's done, and what we've done, because what He did at the cross cancels out whatever we did that's on that pile. He's a good, good father. I mean, He really is. And so here's the phrase. He says, let God transform you. God transforms us into new people by what? By when we change the way we think. He says, then you'll know what God wants you to do, and you'll know how good and pleasing and perfect His will really is. So let's look a little more closely at what Paul had to say about this. Verses 15 and 16. Perhaps you could think of it this way. Onesimus ran for a little while so that you could have him back forever. Let me ask, how many of you, honestly, you surrendered your life to Christ right after you got married or engaged because life was so incredibly good for you and it couldn't get any better? Or maybe you surrendered your life to Christ after you finished school and you got the dream job and you're getting paid more money than you ever thought you would make, and all of a sudden you got that new house or that new vehicle or that new XYZ, and you're on top of the world and you're thinking, God, life is so good. How could I do anything but surrender my life to you? My guess is that's not the commentary on 98% of the people that come to Christ. My guess is that most of us moved closer to God when the bottom dropped out. I mean, when you were served divorce papers, when somebody in your family fell ill and died prematurely, when you lost that job, when you were fired, when you were canned, when the relationship broke apart, when the business deal fell through, when life was falling apart, is when you began to look up. And when you began to look up, all you had in front of you was a mess. But at that point is when you surrendered your life to Christ and He took you just as you were and then brought you over to here and made you somebody that you never were before. My guess is, if we took a show of hands, the vast majority of us would say, yeah, Keith, that's a little bit more in line or aligned with how I came to Christ. Not when everything was great, but when it was a mess. So Onesimus ran away for a little while. My point is, do you think, listen, do you think that maybe God in His sovereign goodness allowed you to go down a difficult road for a little while because He knew that's what it would take to bring you to Him, and once He got you, then He all of a sudden was like, mission accomplished, the Father saying, I've really captured what I wanted, which was to have a relationship with you, and He allowed you to go down a dark path just for a little while so He could have you forever. Come on. That's how good he is. Wouldn't you rather go through a dark season for a season so you could be right with him for all of eternity than to have a life in this world, in this dimension in which we live, where you never struggled, you never had a bad day, everything went the way you wanted to, everywhere you turned, everything turned to gold, you never lacked money, you never were sick, you lived for 105 years, and it was a perfect life here on this planet, but you died, and you died without Christ. Guess what? You spend a lot of eternity, all of eternity. I mean, you know, there's only so much of eternity. It's all or nothing. You spend all of it separated from him forever, because life was just so good. He's no longer just a slave. He's a beloved brother, especially to me. Now, everybody say now. He, meow. That's a sound that we all should hear from cats. They're on their way to, yeah. Now he will mean much more to you, both as a slave and as a brother in the Lord. Listen to me. As we change our thinking, God changes our perspective, and suddenly, listen to this, we have eyes to see what we couldn't see before. Listen, it was always there. You just didn't have eyes to see it. Let me break this down a little further. I've referenced it before. If you go through our Next Steps classes, I talk about it a little bit. Not always, so sometimes I do, sometimes I forget. But it's really what is called our reticular activating system. We all have one. A reticular activating system. It's a lot like when someone has car fever. How many ever had car fever? How many have car fever right now? You're thinking about that car that you would love to have that you still don't have. Have you ever had it? It's when you identify a car that you'd like to have. You know the make, the model, the year, etc., the color even. And the next day you're driving to work and you see that car or a version of it everywhere. How many of you know what I'm talking about? It's like, wow, there's Subarus all over the place. There's XYZ all over the place. Whatever it is, there's a F-250 everywhere. Everybody's driving a honking F-250. Crawling over my little Pinto. And you're thinking, I'm going to get one of those, and I'm going to drive over your little Pinto as well. And you think, it must be God that I get one of these, because I don't see those cars. Matter of fact, I didn't even see them yesterday. What happened? Your reticular activating system was awakened to something that was always there. You just didn't see it before. Some of you are so focused on this that you can't see the possibilities of what could be on the other side of it. But I'm trusting the Holy Spirit to use this message today with such graphic illustration that you'll never forget it. Your eyes are going to be opened, and you're going to move from a place where you're going to see something that you never saw before. And the bottom line is this. How many of you know, we find what we're looking for. Proverbs 11:27. He who seeks good finds goodwill, but evil comes to him who searches for it. What the wisdom of Solomon is saying, you'll find what you're looking for. And once your reticular activating system is set to looking for the good of what God can do, even through or in the midst of or because of or in spite of the bad, you'll begin to see it unfold in your life. And all of a sudden you have a new awareness, and God will begin to propel you into a place of usefulness where before you hid under this cloud of feeling useless. There were two little boys. They were 10 years old at the time, and they were twins. But they were exactly the opposite. And Bill, for a lack of better reference, because I'll protect their identities, Bill was a die-hard optimist. And his brother Bob, well, he was a hopeless pessimist. And the mom asked the psychiatrist what to do about those dynamics, because they were trying to work through some of the differences in the family dynamics and what to do about Christmas. And the doctor told her to buy all the toys she could for Bob and just shower him with gifts and get Bill nothing. So give everything to the pessimist, give the optimist nothing. In fact, he said, just why don't you actually do this? Why don't you wrap up some of this for Bill for Christmas? And so Christmas morning came, and Mom went downstairs and found her little 10-year-old twins by the tree. And she asked Bob what Santa had brought him. And Bob, sitting there in the midst of boxes and wrapping paper all torn apart around him, said, well, I got a BB gun, but I'll probably hit someone in the eye and blind them. And I got a bicycle, but I'll probably go out there on the road and get run over and get killed while I'm riding it. And I got this electric train, but I'm probably going to electrocute myself. How many of you, things aren't going so well? Once a pessimist, always a pessimist. Realized that it wasn't going so well, Mom turned to Bill and asked him what he got. Guess what Bill said? Mom, I'm not sure. I think I got a pony, but I haven't found him yet. You find what you're looking for, friends. You'll find what you're looking for. You look for the bad, you'll find it. You look for the stuff, you'll find it. How many of you know some people, they're obsessed with the stuff? That's all they see. You work with some people like that, don't you? They come in and nothing's ever good. Nothing's ever XYZ. It's just, this is a problem, that's a problem, this is a problem, that's a problem. All they can see, listen to me, all they can see is what's not working. And I even have friends in my past who used to almost pat themselves on the back and say, well, that's just how I'm wired, I'm predisposed that way, I'm what you would call a negative sorter. I said, no, you're just negative. You'll find what you're looking for. Look for the good, and you can see the hand of God at work in any situation you're facing. It really does depend on what you're looking for and thinking about. And so Paul's writing this letter. He says, perhaps you could think of it this way. What about you personally? In what way do you need to look for the good through the bad? I think there are a significant number of people in the Bible who failed, sinned, or were in a bad situation, yet went on to be greatly used by God. They listen, the commentary of their life without God is this, but God. Everybody say, but God. But God stepped in, God broke in, and the outcome was radically different. Let me give you a few examples. Abraham lied and was later called God's friend. David committed adultery and was later called the man after God's own heart. Jonah refused God's assignment and yet rediscovered it later on. Matthew committed extortion and later became one of Jesus' original followers, disciples. Peter denied even knowing Christ, and later we know the story. God used him as his spokesperson on the day of Pentecost, and 3,000 people got saved and were added to the church in one day. Paul fiercely opposed Christ and later became his greatest witness advocate and wrote probably somewhere in the realm of at least 30 some, if not 50% of the New Testament, some scholars would acknowledge. I'm just here to tell you, these people had flaws and weaknesses. They sinned, they messed up, they had their stuff, but none of them were declared useless to God. And the same is true for you and me. Listen to what it says. Perhaps you could think of it this way. He ran away for a little while so you could have him back forever. He's no longer just a slave. He's a beloved brother, especially to me. Now he will mean much more to you both as a slave and as a brother. So here's the question that you've all, not all, some of you wanted to know. So what's the outcome of Onesimus' life? Did he actually return with the letter that Paul wrote to his friend Philemon? And if so, was he snuffed out? Was he executed? Because that was what was expected in the culture of that day. And so, did Philemon kill him or did he let him off the hook? Did he really forgive him? Did he re-engage with him? What I'm about to tell you is based on something that it's actually called scholarly speculation. And I needed to preface what I'm going to tell you with that. That means scholars take different pieces of history, and as they put all the pieces of the puzzle together, it paints a pretty clear picture of what they can almost guarantee happened. So that's the context. That being said, here's what most biblical scholars and historians believe happened to Onesimus. Years later, there was a guy named Ignatius who wrote a letter to the church in Ephesus. And in this letter, he wrote about the pastor of the church in Ephesus. Ephesus was known at that time as the most powerful and influential city in the entire first century. It was the center of commerce. It was like prosperity abounded. It was flourishing. It was growing. And there was all kinds of crazy cool stuff going on in Ephesus. And there was also a temple known as the Temple of Diana. And Diana was the sex goddess, and it was a very perverted, distorted view and expression of sex, and it was destroying the moral and spiritual fiber of the entire city. So the entire city was affected by the Temple of Diana, which was a part of their religious expression, by the way. I mean, that's twisted. And the church at Ephesus grew to become so influential under the leadership of this pastor, this church shut down the Temple of Diana, which completely changed the spiritual climate of the entire city. It shifted because of the influence of the gospel under the leadership of the pastor. So Ignatius wrote this letter about the pastor of the church, and guess what the pastor's name was? Onesimus. In this letter that Ignatius wrote, he even said, Onesimus was once useless, but now he's become useful. He actually used the same language that Paul used, which, again, was a play on words because the name Onesimus means useful. But he used the exact same language that Paul used in his letter to Philemon, leading us to believe that he was aware of the letter that Paul had written to Philemon on Onesimus' behalf. This leads to another interesting point. Why was this short letter to Philemon allowed to be included in the final canon of Scripture, the New Testament as we know it? How many of you know a lot of letters that were written, even different accounts of the gospel, didn't make the cut? So why this letter? Why was this one allowed in? It's a very valid question. After all, it doesn't teach anything that's like pointing out a heresy or anything. It's just a letter Paul wrote to a friend on behalf of his son in the faith who he met and led to Christ. Well, how many would agree? Paul probably did that for hundreds, if not thousands, of young people. Why this one is singled out? Well, it was in Ephesus that all of Paul's letters were first assembled. So scholars believe that there was this pastor who pote was useless, but de nuni became useful both to those around them and to the greater good of God's kingdom, and therefore argued strongly that the letter was worthy to be included in the final canon of Scripture, and it made the cut into the New Testament. All this wouldn't have happened if Paul hadn't taken a risk and believed in what God could do through a nobody, a runaway slave who was, for the most part, useless, who had ripped off his owner. And all through Scripture, you see example after example, those who have gone before mentoring the next generation. Mentors mentioned all through Scripture, like Moses mentoring Joshua and Caleb, and Naomi mentoring Ruth, and Elijah with his son Elisha, and Paul, who had Timothy and Titus, and, oh yeah, let's include this guy named Onesimus. And Saul himself became Paul. See, then there's this master mentor of them all, Jesus, who chose his disciples, the ones who didn't make the cut, the B team. He believed in people who others didn't or wouldn't have believed in. He chose the uneducated, the tax collectors, the fishermen, and entrusted to them the message, mission, and mandate of literally changing the entire world. That's what he left with them when he exited planet Earth. John 15:16, this verse, I don't have time to set it up today. We've taught on it before. We'll probably teach on it in the next series. But in John 15:16, which became a life verse for me after I surrendered my life to Christ, and around the age of 19, it was just this verse screamed to me because of my own journey. And Jesus said this. He said, "You didn't choose me, but I chose you, and I've appointed or ordained you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last forever." See, most of us, are you ready for this? Most of us are where we are today because somebody believed in us. My questions as we move to a place of close, who's your Paul? Who's your Paul? Who believed in you? I want you to literally write their name down, or if you're taking notes, on your mobile device, capture it. Would you send them a note this week? And just say, hey, thank you. You need to know that to a great extent, under the influence of God's grace, He used you to help me to get to where I am today. I wouldn't be where I am without you. Thank you. Just maybe an old school note. And then on the other side of that coin, who's your Onesimus? What do I mean by that? Who is it that you are pouring your life into? Who is it that you've singled out and you say, I see what they don't even see in themselves? Draw attention to it this week. Send them a note and just say, hey, I just want you to know this is what I see in you, and I believe in you, and I see God doing great things through you. Because I guarantee you, somewhere in our spiritual journey, we all have a Paul, and we all should have some Onesimuses, plural. God Himself believes in you. Listen to me. If you don't get anything else today, get this. He created you with greatness in mind. He created you to be useful. He took a risk on you. He sent Jesus to pay the ultimate price. And He, listen, I believe He's calling some of you out today. He's calling you out of your mess and your past into your future, where you're going to have a message that'll bring transformation to those that He puts in your path. But remember, He can't use this unless we give this to Him. We can't deny it. We can't cover it over. We can't try to pretend like it didn't happen. Whether it's something that somebody did to you or it's something that you did on your own volition, either way, God says, give it to me and I'll turn your mess into a message. That's His invitation. So where are you at with all of this? Some of you could honestly say, Keith, I feel like I couldn't be more in the zone at this season of my life. I mean, I'm hitting on all cylinders. I am right where God wants me. I'm on stride. I feel like I'm at the top of my game, and God has already taken me from there to here because I've already surrendered all my mess to Him, and I am living out my God-ordained message. Or are any of you somewhere, maybe in two worlds, really? You've given your life to Him, and you're trying to serve Him, but there's still some stuff in your life. The stuff that you're embarrassed by, the stuff that you've covered over, the stuff that you don't want anybody to know because you're embarrassed, you're ashamed, you have deep remorse over it, but it's there. And God's saying, what is it that you need to surrender to me today? What lie do you need to renounce? And what truth do you need to embrace? And what is it that you need to give to me today? Some of you, it's the totality of your life. You've never surrendered your life to Christ. Today is your day. Today can be your pote de nuni experience. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for who You are. You really are. I mean, you are so good, it's almost beyond our comprehension. Lord, there's so much I feel like going on in this room right now in people's hearts and minds and souls, and I'm asking You, Holy Spirit, to capture it, to just help us to pause the busyness, the activity of life, and to listen to Your voice, to receive Your grace, to receive Your love, to receive Your forgiveness, and to transition today, to allow You to transform us as we change our thinking, as we change the way we think.